Good morning, everybody. Welcome to worship at New Church. We doing good? Yeah. Doing good this morning? So what are we doing here today? What are we doing? Are you ready for Sabbath rest? Sabbath rest. Restoration. Are you ready to hear the commandments of God and be challenged by them? To love God with everything you have, everything you are. To worship God by learning how to love people. That same love that He showed you. Are you ready to hear the sweet words of grace and mercy and forgiveness? The gospel. That God loved you first. You hear that? He doesn't hold your failures against you. Because if so, if you're ready for those things, then you did come to the right place. Because this is church. This is the gathering with a bunch of people who want to end our week and begin our week with worship. And it's important for all of us to spend some time doing this together. So for the first half of our service, we'll all stay in here. At the sermon time, we'll dismiss the young ones to their classes because it's important that we all hear God's word in a context where we can understand it. We've got childcare for the little ones if they get restless. And then after the sermon, as we move into our time of communion today, please go get your kids and bring them back in here so we can do that together too. Let's read this scripture together. This is 1 John chapter 1. 5-7. Let's read it out loud. God is light. In Him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with Him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, His Son, purifies us from all sin. Let's pray as we get started. Father in heaven, we thank you for calling us by name to be here in your presence this morning. We thank you for taking us before the throne room of God this morning so we can sing, so we can be thankful, so we can pray, so we can hear your word. We pray that you would use this time in all of our lives, in our hearts, in our minds, to challenge us, and to comfort us, and to help us grow in our faith and our faithfulness. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
And we continue in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. Let's stand. innocence here, exposing my arrogance all the while, hoping that nobody sees, especially you. I've yielded to all that has cost me, thrown to the side what is free, and I'm lying if I say that I figured it out. Maybe this time the bread and the wine be more than food on my lips, tasting forgiveness, drinking of mercy. You guys can be seated for the reading.
Morning. Today's reading is Exodus 20, 1 through 17. And God spoke all these words, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath of the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you, nor your son or daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his male or his female servant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Jesus Messiah, above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. He became sin, knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Find somebody nearby and just make them feel welcome. We'll be back in a minute. Thank you.
have a seat.
Good morning. Great to see you all. Let's start this time by looking at God's word from 1 Chronicles. Everything that we have comes from you, O Lord, and we give back only what you first gave to us. This is a time that those of us call New Church home give back a portion of what God has given to us as part of our weekly worship. We believe that everything that we have is a gift given to us by God so that we can turn around and gift and bless others. And it's through your faithful giving that we're able to do the ministry and work that we do here at New Church, so thank you. The first $100 of our offering today will go to support the Pregnancy Help Center. It is a local ministry that helps those with unplanned pregnancies. Please pray with me. Gracious Father, with thankful hearts, we give back to you from what you have first given to us. Receive our tithes and offerings today as an act of worship in the name of Jesus. And bless this week's offerings so that it will be enough. Amen. Well, it's real easy to give from your smartphone or computer by visiting newchurch.love/give. You can also text the word give to 832-400-5299. It'll ask you for some setup information at first, but after that, you can simply text the amount to 832-400-5299. If you haven't already set up monthly or weekly giving, now would be a great opportunity to do that. Just remember that it is important that we continue to be faithful in our tithes and offerings in support of the big mission in our work here at New Church. If you're a guest with us today, let us know how you found out about us, that you're here, how we can be praying for you. And you can do that by either filling out a guest card and dropping it in our offering bucket. There is also a digital version of that at newchurch.love/info. We do feel that it is important that you receive God's teaching in an age-appropriate manner. And so during our message time, we have set up the journey and our young ones classes to be able to support our younger men and women, boys and girls, in their growth and understanding of God's word. For our high school students, we do encourage you to stay here and hear the message from Pastor Frank. And with that being said, I think Ms. Holly and Peter and Ms. Amanda are all excited to have you join them for Young Ones and the Journey, so y'all can head on out. Thanks.
Again, name that tune. There we go. There we go. Let's pray as we get started today. Father, we thank you so much for this time when we can gather around your word, your law, your promises, your commands, your grace. We thank you that you promised us that your word is live and powerful and active, and that it does not return to you empty. Do your work here this morning through me, in Jesus' name. Amen. The church is not very popular in popular culture these days. Christians are considered to be heartless, judgmental know-it-alls who just walk around slapping their hateful labels on anyone they disagree with. People think we're close-minded, legalistic, If the world was a junior high school, people would think Christians were the hall monitors, the ones that try to suck up to the principal and the teachers, but secretly even they can't stand them. I'm not cool with any of this. I know it's true, but I hate it. We're not supposed to be like bad traffic cops, just following people around, hoping they do something wrong, cross over the line, or forget to use a turn signal. We can light them up, pull them over, and give them a ticket. It's not how we're supposed to be. But we do deserve this reputation, because we are more known for what we're against than what we're for. We make people far more aware of the things we don't like than the things we love. That doesn't seem right, does it? We're supposed to be known by our love for one another, not our disgust of people who sin different than we do. Today we're continuing in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 6. Jesus is going to run into the hall monitors and bad cops of his day. And I want us to all think about times when maybe we've acted more like these Pharisees than the followers of Jesus that we've been called to be. So Luke chapter 6, verse 1. One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields, and his disciples began to pick some heads of grain, rub them in their hands, and eat the kernels. Some of the Pharisees asked, "Why are you doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath?" It's Saturday, the Sabbath. Jesus probably spent the morning teaching somewhere nearby in a synagogue. Now, he's heading out somewhere with all the disciples following him. He's not on a road. They're walking through someone's field. And they're probably not going very far, or else the Pharisees would have accused them of that too. It says some of the Pharisees. It's not all of them. Remember, we were told that a bunch of Pharisees and teachers of the law had come from all over the country to find something they could accuse Jesus of doing wrong and write him up on charges. So Luke says some of the Pharisees, probably because not all the Pharisees were bad guys, and certainly because this is a smaller group of them. These are the most persistent ones. They are stalking Jesus. They're like amateur private eyes. Jesus even gets off the road, starts walking through someone's field, tries to lose the tail, but they stay right on his heels. Now, the law allowed people to pick a little grain and eat it when you walk through a field. So they weren't trespassing, they weren't stealing, and since the grain was actually ripe enough for them to eat, it's probably about this time of year, like close to April. Well, apparently, Jesus wasn't joining them in their delicious feast of raw grain. But the Pharisees accused him anyway, because whatever his followers did, it's like Jesus was doing it too. Let that sink in, because it's still true. We represent Jesus to the world. What they see us do, that's what they assume about him too. So they ask, "Why are you doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath?" And Jesus doesn't argue with them about whether it was against the law or not. We would have. He doesn't defend himself. He defends his friends. But the truth is, there wasn't anything wrong with what they were doing. Exodus 20 says to remember the Sabbath, to keep it holy, to not work on the Sabbath. So unless you consider picking up grain with your hands and putting it in your mouth to be work, then they weren't doing anything wrong. They were allowed to walk a short distance and to eat on the Sabbath. So there's no violation going on here, which is important, because breaking the Sabbath, that was a big deal. It could carry the death penalty. That's why they were so obsessed with finding some technicality that Jesus was breaking. They wanted him dead. Verse 3. Jesus answered them, "Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry? He entered the house of God, and taking the consecrated bread, he ate what is lawful only for priests to eat. He also gave some to his companions. Then Jesus said to them, 'The Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath.'" So Jesus is like, okay, clearly, you all got your man-made rules and additions to the law memorized. But have you actually read your freaking Bible? Which points out their main problem. Too much reading of rabbinical law, not enough reading of God's law. He brings up a story about David from 1 Samuel, when he was on a military campaign with a small band of soldiers, and they were hungry. So they went to the tabernacle, and the priest let them eat some consecrated bread that was supposed to only be for priests. It was called the bread of the presence. 12 loaves of fresh bread were put in the holy place in the presence of God as an act of worship every Sabbath. This was probably the previous Sabbath's bread. But there's still no getting around this. David and his men were not supposed to eat it. Jesus assumes, though, that the Pharisees agree with him, that David did the right thing in taking the bread, eating it, and sharing it with his friends, even though the law technically forbids it. See, the Pharisees, they make the same mistake we all do. They're really familiar with a few favorite verses, but they're not able to combine all of Scripture together in their understanding of what it all means. In order for Jesus' answer to make any sense to us, we got to understand something the Pharisees knew, that the events of David's life point to the days of the Messiah. They point to the Son of David. Okay, you need to write this at the top of every page of your Bible. Just take a pen and just write this at the top, because this is the secret to understanding everything in it. You ready? On the top of every page, Old Testament and every page of the New Testament, write this. This page is about Jesus. So he tells them the story about David, the consecrated bread. And if they would have believed that Jesus was the Son of David, the Messiah, that would have been the end of it, resolved. But of course, they didn't believe. The Pharisees looked at the world through the law, black and white, rules and regulations. To them, God was a cold-hearted, merciless monster who was just looking for a reason to crush people. So when the Pharisees came to Jesus and they asked him what the most important commandment is, if we want to be on God's good side, which one of these commandments is going to be on the test? Which one really matters? You remember what Jesus' answer to them was? Because he said, this is the most important commandment. Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And also, love your neighbor as yourself. And it's not that those are the top two rules. It's more like they're a way to understand all the rest of them. They're the whole point of God's law. Not to get him to love us, but to show us how to love him. So if you really want to understand God's commands, what he wants us to do, here's the key. Every one of those commands is a way to either love God or to love someone in your life. None of them are just harsh and cruel legal requirements to make life suck. They're all a blessing. They're the way God designed life to work. They're like holy life hacks. There's the spirit of the law and there's the letter of the law. The Pharisees only understood the letter of the law, black and white. Love is the overriding spirit of the law, all of it. We don't seem to understand this either, because we think God's commandments are this imposing, burden, just put there to beat us down, suck all the joy out of life, hoops we have to jump through in order to get God to like us. That couldn't be further from the truth. In Mark chapter 2, 27, Jesus said, "The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath," which means the Sabbath was commanded so that God's people would rest, so they wouldn't burn out, so they wouldn't forget to worship, forget to trust in Him, rely on His goodness. This is the only way life works. And the same thing is true for all the other commandments. They're all supposed to help us understand how to love God and how to love the people in our lives. They show us how to keep from ruining our relationships, to keep from burning out, sabotaging our life. So in this sense, the same thing is true for the entire law that's true for the Sabbath. The law was made for man, not man for the law. But these Pharisees, they were just sure they could catch Jesus breaking some Sabbath rule. So he shuts their whole entire argument down. He says, "The Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath." He's the Son of Man. He's the Son of God, fully human, fully divine. He's the Messiah. He's the Lord. He's the God who came up with the idea of Sabbath. You think you're going to explain the finer details of it to him? You think there's something about the Sabbath that he doesn't understand? He's the Lord of the Sabbath. The lawmaker. He's not saying that because he's God, the Sabbath doesn't apply to him. He's not saying he can break the rules if he wants to. He's the Messiah, the Christ. He's not going to break any of God's laws. He agrees with the Pharisees about that. He wasn't breaking the Sabbath, and neither were his followers. He's the Lord of the Sabbath. And saying that, that made their heads explode. Verse 6. On another Sabbath, he went into the synagogue and was teaching. And a man was there whose right hand was shriveled. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus. So they watched him closely to see if he would heal on the Sabbath. Same song, different verse. Jesus is teaching in the synagogue on another Sabbath day. The religious haters, they show up and they want to catch him doing something wrong. The only reason they were there, there's a guy who has a shriveled up hand just sitting there, minding his own business, listening to the greatest teacher who's ever lived. Let that sink in a little. These Pharisees and teachers of the law were some of the luckiest people who ever lived. They're actually being taught by God Himself. But do they appreciate that? No. They're just obsessed with secretly hoping Jesus does something really evil, like heal a man with a deformed right hand on the Sabbath. Man, those are some blind black hearts, you know? They didn't doubt that Jesus could heal. They just wanted to catch him doing it on the Sabbath. Verse 8. But Jesus knew what they were thinking and said to the man with the shriveled hand, "Get up and stand in front of everyone." So he got up and stood there. Then Jesus said to them, "I ask you, which is lawful on the Sabbath, to do good or to do evil, to save life or to destroy it?" There is definitely an element of drama to how Jesus does things. He's the author of time, space, reality, every story that's ever happened. So we shouldn't be surprised that he makes a powerful presentation of this moment. They would have been in the synagogue sitting cross-legged on the floor. Jesus would have also been sitting, but up on a little platform where they could see him while he was teaching. He'd already read the scripture. We're not told what it was. He was teaching, kind of like what we're doing here this morning. And as he's talking, and looking around at the people in the room, he knows what they're thinking. I'm probably glad that I don't know what you guys are thinking. No one said anything. He just knew. The guy with the gimpy hand, he didn't ask to be healed. He wasn't complaining about his hand. He's just sitting there in church. Jesus calls him out. Hey, you with the shriveled hand, stand up. Anybody want me to call them out like that? You, come, stand in front of everybody. I'm going to make a lesson out of you. I don't think so. So he interrupts his own teaching to do this. The guy with the bad hand, now he's standing up, wondering what the heck. Jesus looks at all the black-hearted Pharisees and scribes, one by one, right in the eyes. They hadn't said anything either. And then he asks them, since it's the Sabbath, what's the law say I should do here? Good or evil? Should I save life or destroy it? And he kind of lets the question linger in the air for a moment. Make sure they felt the weight of it. No one answered. Verse 10, he looked around at them all, and then he said to the man, stretch out your hand. He did so, and his hand was completely restored. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law were furious and began to discuss with one another what they might do to Jesus. He didn't touch the man. He didn't say any magic phrase like, I rebuke your crippled hand. Be healed. Receive this in the powerful name of me. He didn't prance around like a faith healer. The man didn't fall down in the power of the Holy Ghost. Jesus just looked at him and said, hey, show me your hand. The guy might have been just as surprised as everyone else. Say what? Huh, looky there. His hand is completely restored. And then the men who were trying to trap Jesus, they lose their mind. They're furious. They're mad. This is pure madness. Can you imagine being so intent on destroying someone who was actually helping people, giving someone the use of their hand, that would upset you? Jesus proves that he's the Son of Man, the Lord of the Sabbath, by healing that guy. It's a life-changing moment for him. He would have been using his left hand for everything up till now. And if you know anything about the ancient world, that was gross. Let's just say toilet paper and running water hadn't been invented yet. This was going to improve his social life. These religious leaders, they were so obsessed with taking down Jesus, so blind to the actual purpose of God's commands for his people. They had such a warped view of who God is, they thought it was actually better to try and destroy Jesus on the Sabbath than for Jesus to heal someone. They didn't answer Jesus' question either, before the miracle or after. But Luke kind of answers it for us. They believed it was better to destroy life than to save it, because they wanted to destroy Jesus' life. They started talking about what they might do to him, and they certainly don't want to do anything good. Let's talk about the Sabbath for a minute. In Exodus, Moses gave the Ten Commandments. One of them is remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. And he explains that in creation, God worked for 6 days, and on the seventh day, he rested. So he wants his people to also rest on the seventh day. Keep the day holy to the Lord. Separate that day from the other days. And then 40 years later, in Deuteronomy, Moses refreshes the people's memory about the Ten Commandments. And when he talks about the Sabbath day, this time, instead of creation, he ties it to the Exodus and God rescuing his people from slavery in Egypt. So the Sabbath, like everything else in the Bible, points to Jesus. the recreation of the world through the cross and the resurrection, and the rescuing and salvation of his people through his death, which Jesus actually calls his exodus in Luke 9:31. After Jesus died, he laid in the tomb all day Saturday. You could say he rested and kept the Sabbath until his resurrection on Sunday. So Sabbath was about recreation, recreation. And it's about salvation, freedom from bondage. Sabbath is all about Jesus. And the early church understood this. So they moved their observance of the Sabbath from the seventh day, Saturday, to the eighth day, Sunday, a day that would mysteriously stand between the old and the new, a day of now, not yet, the first day of the week, but also the last day of the week, the first and the last, a new day, a day when the people of God would gather together in Christ and be taken in worship to the throne room of God in the name of Jesus and the power of the Spirit. Do you know that's where you are right now? Because since we are gathered in worship, we are both here and there, earth and heaven, inside of time and outside of time. We're with the people in this room, but we're also with every believer who has ever lived and will ever live, along with all the angels and archangels and company of heaven in this place of Sabbath rest and restoration. See, this is the place where every week you hear the commandments of God and you're challenged to love him with everything you have and everything you are, to worship him by loving all the people in your life the way he showed you. Every week you also hear the sweet words of grace, the gospel, that God loved you first, that he wants what's best for you, that he doesn't hold your failures against you. Think about those last few lessons in the Gospel of Luke. The new wine and the new wineskins. The disciples eating grain on the Sabbath. Because in a few minutes, we're going to celebrate communion, where you'll be fed the true bread of the true presence of the body of Christ. Where you'll drink the true new wine of his blood. Where your sins are forgiven. Your life is made new. Okay, let me wrap this thing up. When we started, I was talking about how the church has a bad reputation. And the main reason for that bad reputation is our misunderstanding of God's commandments, God's law. Our misunderstanding of his law and our pathetic lack of applying it to ourselves is the main problem. We're not supposed to look at it the way the Pharisees looked at it. Like God's law is this dreaded list of rules that suck all the joy out of life. Like keeping the law somehow earns us brownie points with God. Like we can use it as a club to accuse people and beat them down with it. Like we're supposed to apply God's commandments to everyone else except for ourselves. Can we just admit for a minute that God is still working on every one of us? All our secret sins, all our not-so-secret sins. Can we admit that God's not done with us? That we're all a work in progress? You know, maybe that sin that looks so obvious to you in someone else, maybe that's like way down on the list of things that God is working on in that person's life. We don't need to follow them around and accuse them. How about if we put all that effort instead, put all of our effort into showing people grace? How about that? You received grace. Share that grace with other people. love people. And if you want to understand how to love someone, if you want to understand how to love God, just look at his law, his commandments, because they are the very definition of what love is. Today we looked at two times the enemies of Jesus tried to trap him on the Sabbath, using God's law to try to destroy the Son of God. Kind of dumb. The Sabbath is a perfect example of how God's law shows us how to love him and how to love the people in our life, to do both things. God commands us to remember the Sabbath day, to keep it holy. So we come together on Sunday morning to worship God, to thank God, to honor him, to show him our love and our affection in response to his love and his affection for us. We also show love to our family by bringing them to church and doing our best, like our heart, soul, mind, and strength, our best, with our emotions, our spiritual experiences, our intellectual stimulation, our singing, praying, and physically being here, doing our best to build our life and our family's life on that firm foundation. And we love our friends by showing up here, encouraging them in their faith. Encourage them to be here. Just by being here ourselves is the best encouragement you can do. We show love to our extended community, Katie, and beyond, by talking about the hope and faith that we have in Jesus and inviting them to join us here. See, the Sabbath is a perfect example of how all of these things come together. God's law, God's grace, to love God, to love people, to worship God and love people. Not because God's going to zap you if you don't do it, but because it's a perfect picture of what love looks like. Then we take all these gifts that we receive when we come together here, and we apply it to everything else in our life. Maybe they really can know that we're Christians by our love. Amen. As we move into our time of communion this morning, I want to remind everyone that this is a holy sacrament that was instituted by the Lord himself. So if you know that you're a sinner, if you know that you're in need of God's mercy, if you're baptized, if you're walking in Christian unity in as much as it depends on you, if New Church is your church home, and if you take Jesus at his word when he said, "This is my body and this is my blood," then we invite you to come forward to receive God's forgiveness. We believe the Lord's Supper is a means of God's grace. This is our altar call, and it's for everyone. Even if you have questions about what we believe concerning the technicalities of this meal, we still invite you to come forward, cross your arms like this, to show that you want to pass on the bread and the wine this time, but you still want to receive grace, the blessing of absolution. You still want forgiveness. Let's confess our sin together to Almighty God. Let's say this out loud. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. On the night when Jesus was handed over, he took bread, And when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Take and drink. This cup is the new covenant of my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are proclaiming the mystery. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again." Invite the servers to come forward. So we have individual cups of wine, and we have the little wafers that represent bread. They are made with wheat. They are bread, but they seem like more of a stretch of imagination than body and blood, if you ask me. We'll have four stations around the room. We'll have two up here in front, one over here on the side, and then one in the back. And so what we ask is, after I serve my helpers here this morning, then we ask that you would also go and line up individually, single file, to receive communion. Let's turn the music on.
God would welcome me into this mystery. Say, take this bread, take this wine, now the simple made divine for any to receive. By your mercy we come to your table, by your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we remember you, and remembrance leads us to worship, and as we
God, we thank you for feeding us in this holy mystery. Your body, which was broken for us, your blood, which was shed for the forgiveness of all our sins. Help us to walk in the light of this new life that you've given us by grace through faith. Amen.
The law of God, the word of God, is predicated on who God is, on his nature. It's not just arbitrary rules he came up with. It's the way God is. And he made us in his image so that by obeying the law, obeying his word, we could be free. That's the point. We could be free. We could be who we were made to be as images of God. And we should remember this, because when people fail to keep God's word, you know, they're hurting themselves. And it's easier to not be angry when you realize that they're doing themselves an injury. And for for us to not be so freaking proud about it when we obey the word. We should keep these things in mind. Now's the time when we pray for the needs of the church. This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. If you have an illness and you would like to be healed, I would suggest you stick your hand up in the air and one of our elders who have oil will come and put healing oil on you. And if you have a need and you stick your hand up, they'll come and pray with you as well. So, Kielski, all right, let's pray together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, your mercies are new every morning. And though we deserve only punishment, you receive us as your children and provide for all our needs of body and soul. Grant that we may heartily acknowledge your merciful goodness, give thanks for all your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. We ask, Lord, that you would protect the Christians in Ukraine and Russia and their current struggle. Father, we also lift up to you the various needs in our church. We lift up to you those who are sick or who are facing medical procedures. We lift up to you Phyllis and K.O., Michelle, Wade, Rick, Ed, Isabel, Tom, Mary Lou, Jay, Carol and Nate, Dwayne, David, Katie, Adrian, Hudson, Laura. We lift up to you as well, Lord, Tommy and Angelina and Alan, and ask that you would be with them and heal them and all the others that we're thinking of and praying right now for. We lift up those who are having relationship problems and ask you to heal those relationships. We lift up those who need money or a job and ask you would provide for them, Lord. We lift up those who are tired or sad. We ask that you would be their joy and that you would restore the joy of salvation. We lift up Texas and the United States and pray that our leaders would believe the gospel and would help us to be a light for all nations. We lift up our ministry partners, Hope Impacts and the Pregnancy Help Center. Provide for them, guard them, and use them, O Lord. We ask that you would give New Church a permanent home. And we pray for your church throughout all the world to be faithful in the mission that you've called us to do. And Lord, if there's anybody here this morning who hasn't repented of their sin and confessed their need of the Savior and haven't believed on Jesus' name, we pray that they would hear the gospel today, turn away from death, and begin to walk in faith and new life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Now let us pray as the Lord Jesus has taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine on you, be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you his peace. You have been blessed so that you can be a blessing. Thanks for being here this week, guys. We've got a few announcements. We'll see you next week.
All right. Yes, just a few announcements. As always, you can find out what's going on with New Church by visiting newchurch.love/info and clicking on Church Biz. It's also a nice refresher for anything that I don't go over correctly. So, Easter is coming soon, and we need your help. One of our traditions is to provide some plastic Easter egg opportunities for some young people. So if you could gladly find it in your time to get together some plastic stuffed with candy Easter eggs, there's a drop bin right in the back there near the entrance and exit. And bring those over the next couple weeks. It'll build up a nice little fun opportunity for our kiddos. So, the National Youth Gathering is approaching quickly as well. Parents, if you have youth that are attending that event, the payment portal through newchurch.love/give has some drop-down menus for both the National Youth Gathering and in a sub drop-down with your child's name in there. And you can simply go in there and pick their name to make your payments. But if you don't have kids going and you'd like to help someone that might need some assistance, the last item on the student or youth name list is an opportunity to help someone that needs assistance. So please pray about that. And if you find in your heart to help in that opportunity, please do so. One of the things that today's message reminded me of is the New Testament simplicity on God's law, combined with infusing it with gospel, and the simplicity of worship God, love people, which is also our church mission, allows us to come together on a Sabbath and be reminded of that regularly and recreate. Frank used the term recreate, right? Sunday is that opportunity to recreate our focus. We're in worship with God, and then what is our intent to love people throughout the week and be reminded of that every Sunday? And so in that same way, it kind of brings you to the next thing we've been talking about a lot is that being fishers of men, going out and casting nets on people. And so I ask you today, who can you go to in your life that isn't here, that isn't at a church, and just tell them how much you love your church? You know, you don't start planting those seeds, casting those nets, having conversations about how awesome your church is and how you love the people that you worship with and hang out with during the week. And then God will put on your heart at the right time to then invite them to join us. If you need some help with that, we have some invite cards back there by the exit. Grab a stack of those. It's a nice little easy thing to hand to someone. Say, hey, here's some information about my church. I'd love to see you there. Right? Pray about that. Pray for them. Pray for our church. And lastly, if someone does show up, like, we all need to be here. We need to make a commitment to that for someone else's friends that show up. And then go meet those people. Go love on them and let them know, like, this is an awesome place to be. And this is an awesome, it's not just here on Sunday. Like, I know all of us have people that we do things with throughout the week on weekends that rejoin us on Sunday. And we can talk about, oh, remember what we did on Friday, Wednesday, whatever it was, right? And so having someone come in and then hear that and then be part of that conversation, then maybe be invited to something that happens during the week as well, is just, those are things that we can be doing. And so just pray on that. Pray for our church. I want to see us grow big. I want to see us get into our own building. And, that board over there is green. That's awesome. That's awesome. So we're moving in the right direction to get our place. And we just have so many places to go once that happens. So, as always, invite someone to lunch today. Who's going to lunch? Jim, you always go to lunch. Where are you going?
I don't know, Greg. Where are we going?
I don't know. Just start having conversations. Anybody else have a place they're going yet? All right. Have some conversations. Invite someone to lunch. Y'all have a great week. See you next one.